Judica me Deus, et discerna causam meam. Burn vi, O Diu, ac adnabod vi. Search thou me, O Lord, and know me. And now, my dear and loyal followers, after 14 years of exile in Brittany, I, Henry Tudor, have returned to my homeland of Wales and proclaim my rightful inheritance to the royal crown of England. And with your brave strength, and the guidance of Almighty God, we will destroy that tyrant, King Richard III, who now unjustly rules over you.
Hear, hear. Three cheers for Henry Tudor. Hip, hip.
Hooray!
Hip, hip.
Hooray!
Hip, hip.
Hooray!
And three boos for wicked Richard III.
Oh, look, Mr. Evans, I do really think that the latter's unnecessary.
Oh, yes.
No, let us hold to the historical facts as far as we're able. All right.
Now, where was I? Oh, yes, yes, I remember. And now, as a token of my acceptance of your loyal support, I first call forth Billy Bear de Chandé.
The sword, Mr. You don't mind being a Frenchman, now, do you, Peter? Oh, good. Arise, Sir Philibert.
And I now call forth David Owen. Arise, Sir, not till I finish, boy. Arise, Sir David. Now, the truth is, Henry Tudor knighted, bestowed the accolade on several other of his supporters who'd landed here with him. But since we have a great deal to do, that will have to suffice. No more knights, sorry. Now, as you'll recall from your lessons last term, and as you saw me demonstrate coming out of the sea, Henry Tudor landed here secretively at Mill Bay, Pembrokeshire, in southwest Wales, which is the very spot that we are standing on now. What was the date of his landing?
August the 7th, 1485.
Good.
Around 6:30 p.m.
Is there any historical evidence for 6:30 in the evening?
Oh, yes, definitely, Mr. Meredith, yes.
Very good, Sandra, very good.
He had about 1,500 Frenchmen with him, along with a lot of his Welsh friends.
Thank you, Sandra. Now, all of you, think carefully. What exactly do we know about this man, Henry Tudor?
Sir, sir!
Here, Dennis.
He was born of a Vershire, Pembroke Castle.
Not over by there, boy. Over by there, I mean Pembroke Castle south. Now, what else do you know? Oh, dear. None.
His mother was 13 when he was born, and his father died when Henry was still inside his mother's tummy.
Correct.
He was looked after by a lovely nurse who taught him Welsh and English, and sang songs during the night before he went to sleep in the castle.
No doubt. Yes, and what do you know about Henry Tudor, Gareth Jones?
Henry Tudor was the first hope for Welsh emancipation. So he's a real Prince of Wales, Owain Glyndŵr.
Well said, Gareth.
Yes, well, that is basically correct.
Do you know what emancipation means, Kenneth?
Yes, sir. Freedom, independence.
Yes, that's right.
Sir.
Sandra.
His grandfather, whose name was Owain Tudor, came from Anglesey, North Wales, and he married the widow of King Henry V.
Excellent, Sandra. Excellent. Now, the next question is, what
had poor Richard III done to make many people in Great Britain want another king, bearing in mind, children, that it was not only Welshmen who welcomed Henry Tudor to this shore. Now.
Because Richard III had murdered the little princes in the Tower of London.
Yes, well, it is generally believed that Richard III murdered the little princes in the Tower, but no one can be sure, you see.
Mr. Meredith, there can be no doubt about that.
But all I am saying, Miss Evans, is that there is no categorical proof. Look, many people have been swayed by William Shakespeare and, with all due respect, by Laurence Olivier. Now, but I am sure that we are all serious historians here. Why did Henry Tudor choose this spot, far away from England, land? Young Henry Tudor, the Welshman, had come home, bearing his red dragon banner, and he was about to make a historic journey, full of terrible perils, because he was going to look for King Richard III and fight him for the crown of England, which is exactly what we are going to do ourselves. Children, forward! Look, Gareth, from now on, you can take the part of Henry Tudor. Yes, I think you are the most suitable for the job.
Thank you, sir.
Do. Oh, well done, boy. Do you know where Miss Evans left my shoes? Oh, Miss Evans! Oh, do you? Oh! Well, children, we're very lucky with the weather. I've been up here when it's been teeming with rain. Miss Evans will tell you. She's been up here too. No umbrellas. Come on, everyone in the bus.
I do appreciate your effort on behalf of the children, and I hate to be a burden over these matters. But you know, since the discovery that smoking causes lung cancer, I do feel responsible towards the children. I really do appreciate... No. And I realize what a pull such an addiction must be. Thank you. Thank you. No, it isn't that. I appreciate the act of will, dear. Thank you. Thank you.
Got their maps, Miss Evans?
Anyone not got a map of our journey?
Now, here is an important question. Where was King Richard III when Henry Tudor landed? Eh? Right, I'll give you a clue, but think carefully. A clue. Robin Hood.
Sir,
yes,
sir.
Yes, Arthur Roman.
Sherwood Forest, sir.
Oh, Dew Arthur, man, I asked you to think carefully. Sherwood Forest. Yes, Seth John.
Nottingham Castle, sir.
Correct.
You should have said Sheriff of Nottingham.
It was a daft. You'd have said the name then, stupid.
Who are you calling stupid?
Who do you think? Stop it! Stop it, you naughty boys.
Anyway, correct, Seth John. Richard III was at Nottingham, and Nottingham is at the centre of England. Richard was no fool. You see, London is not England. Richard was poised to move in any direction, and he wanted soldiers to join him from all parts of the country.
It has always seemed to me that Richard III of Nottingham was like a spider, a tarantula in the middle of his web, waiting to pounce.
Yes, well, look, I'm not sure that he was as bad as a tarantula, Miss Evans. But their children, you see, that is one of the interesting things about history. No two people think exactly alike. Now, Miss Evans and I think differently about certain aspects of this story, and so does Gareth. Well, I mean, Gareth is going to lead the Welsh Nationalist Party, Clyde Cymru, one of these fine days. It is up to you to listen to all of the arguments and think for yourselves. See, that is the road of democracy. Now, one of the first incidents on this journey, as local tradition would have us believe, happened on and around this little bridge we are now approaching. Let's just pull into the usual place. Oh. Now, there is a very important part going. Who wants to be Rhys ap Thomas?
Yes, sir.
Peter Howell, come on, quick boy. Now, you go with Miss Evans, but be careful on the road. Some of these visitors can be very wild indeed.
Here you are, son. Take it. Good boy.
Oh, dear, where am I now? Oh, yes. Miss Evans!
Yes?
Have you got the words?
Okay.
Oh, good girl. Rhys ap Thomas was one of the great magnates, one of the powerful men of South Wales, and he had many Welsh soldiers. Well, King Richard III, always worried, had forced Rhys ap Thomas to make a promise that if ever Henry Tudor tried to advance through South Wales, it would only be over his body. Now, consider that. Only over his body.
Well, this might you look, boy. Oh, Bertel Mach.
Miss Davis, Mary, thank you, dear. Righty ho, Miss Evans! Right, up you get, son. You know your part. Now then, watch this. Right, start, Gareth, boy.
Good morrow, my friend.
Yes, well, remember that you want him very badly on your side, see?
Good morrow, my friend.
My lord, what ho! What a wondrous sight to have you back in our fair isle.
Yes, now you note that was a very hopeful, a very optimistic start to the conversation. Right, Henry Tudor, now carry on, boy.
Aye, that's true, my good friend. I'm thrice blessed.
Oh, blessed.
Blessed am I to be in the principality.
Yes.
My beauteous home, my dear and beloved Wales. This is a noble horse you have. Pray, tell me the name of this fine beast.
Louder this time.
Show it back, sir, my liege.
Isn't it strange how the oddest scraps of conversation come down to us, you see, through these legends. Right, carry on.
Will you join me, Rhys, in my march to place a Welshman on the throne of England?
Ah! Well?
You see, he's hesitating.
If I win, I must surely make you rich, and the south of Wales shall be our own.
'Tis this promise, good Harry. I have given my word to the King Richard that any rebel landing in these parts would advance only over my body.
Now what?
Ah, I have it. Forbear with me a thrice. Dearest, a messenger.
No. Shout it, you see, to our own people here in the bus. A messenger!
A messenger!
Meg, write an imaginary note, boy. Now, Meg, you are the messenger. Take this note, this message, to Rhys ap Thomas. Now, children, watch carefully what Rhys ap Thomas does after he reads Henry Tudor's message.
We shall meet again very soon.
Now remember, children, the oath that Resap Thomas took, that Henry Tudor could advance only over his body, only over his body.
Peter, your feet are wet. Back to the bus.
There, children of the Preseli Mountains. Now look well at them, because our people, long before the Romans came and the Saxons came and the Normans came, our people regarded those mountains as a holy place. We carried mighty slabs of rock from those mountains to build a great temple on faraway Salisbury Plain. What is the remains of that temple today? Right, you Nicholas.
Stonehenge, sir.
Right, you. And what a strange and significant story, children.
Oh, Miss Evans, we feel so sure and we know so little.
Yes. Yes, indeed. There must have been a civilization long before all those invaders came.
Now, boys, don't push.
I saw you coming, sir.
How are you, my boy?
Oh, good, good. Busy, you know?
Oh, well, I'm very, very glad. Oh, tell me, have you got the Knickerbocker glories? You know, the KGs underway?
Of course.
Oh, good boy, good boy.
By the window. I want you all right by the window.
Good morning.
Yes, I recognize some of them.
Hello, Mr. Meredith. Heard a lot about you from Dyer.
Oh, yes,
Miss Florence Probert.
Oh, yes, yes. Well, it's very kind of you, very good of you to have got all this ready for us. Yes.
Well, no one is sick yet. Oh, hello, Di. How nice to see you.
Good afternoon, Miss Evans. Excuse the wet hand.
Oh. Please, sir, I can't feel any part.
Dennis Roberts, I told you. Get back to your seat. Now, come on.
Anyway, today we've got a very special treat for you all. Florence, wheel out the KGs, will you?
Bravo! Bravo!
Well done, Florence.
I think I've just seen Richard Griffith and beyond him, John Morgan, across the room.
Oh, yes, I've been waiting to see him.
Who is this I see approaching? Who is this? Who is this? Now, what I am seeing, children, is in my mind's eye. I am seeing soldiers led by Richard Griffith and John Morgan, and they have come from Sir Walter Herbert Yorkist, that is Richard III's side. And Sir Walter Herbert was a man who would oppose Henry Tudor's progress, so it was said. Therefore, the immediate question was, would Henry Tudor have to fight here in Cardigan? Perhaps he'd get no further. And then Richard Griffith came forward. Henry Tudor must have been in an agony of spirit. And then Griffith said, "My prince, we will fight on your side."
And we were singing hymns and arias, "Land of my fathers, and he then knows.
If to fight and be the road with an empty crate of ale, Will has lost his money now his western mails for sale.
But Will is very happy though his money all has gone. He saw five photos of his wife.
Aggie, Aggie, Aggie! Hey, hey, hey! Aggie, Aggie, Aggie! Hey, hey, hey! Aggie, hey!
Right, children. We'll be picnicking soon. Get yourselves together.
But don't forget, we have a conducted tour first of this beautiful house called a Wern, one of the most famous stopover points during Henry's journey. And in the house, there are many precious objects. Now, all on your best behavior.
Well done. Right. Now, ladies, picnic where we always have it, and as usual, I'll leave the domestic arrangements to yourselves. All right? Look, Maggie, I know how bravely you're suffering, so if you must, have a discreet cigarette here, all right? You see, look, I don't want to be a bore, but I am concerned about your health as well.
Oh, God bless you, Mr. Melendez. I'd like to be without you.
Good girl.
Oh, I wish I had your strength around me all the time.
Oh, well, that would be a pleasure, but, well, you know, Mrs. Meredith might not approve, eh? Good girl, good girl.
Best behavior now, don't touch anything.
Wipe your feet. Be very careful. No damage, no dirt. All right,
Miss
Evans. Going
to
help, Maggie, dear.
Excuse me.
In
here, there's a good...
No, in here, children. That's it. There you are.
No need to bang your feet, children. That's Walk it. Lightly.
In you come. There we are. That's it. Move down there. That's it. Squeeze in the corner.
Hello, T.R.
Hello.
How are you, boy?
Nice to see you. Indeed. Nice to welcome you again.
Mr. T.R. Davies, well done, well done.
Now, children, this is Mr. Davies, our resident guide here. Carry on.
Thank you very much. Now, listen carefully, children. Oh, this is the very room where Henry Tudor, Earl of Richmond, son of Edmund, grandson of Owen Tudor, slept in.
Excuse me, Mr. Davis. Of course now, children, all the conveniences here are very, very modern indeed. Just make that clear.
Yes. Well, politically and economically, the great question of the 15th century, outside Germany, that is, was how far the disintegration of the authority of autocratic despotism would go. Very wide restrictions were founded on a misunderstanding of civil and canonical texts, which had the intention of prohibiting what could be described as shibboleth and pro quo.
Dennis Roberts, you wicked boy, don't you dare do... Now, if any of you get up to that again... I do beg your pardon. That's very distressing for Mr. Davis. Carry on, sir.
Advocates of reform were defeated for the time being by the allegorical and scriptural reasoning of Schmidt, confirmed by papal authority, and it was not until a later date that the Fourth Lateran Council limited the prohibited degrees to the fourth generation from the common ancestor.
Excuse me, Mr. Davis, look, I've got a bit of a problem.
Oh, dear.
Several of the youngsters have been a bit sick, you see. Oh. And Miss Evans and Miss Davis are anxious to put something into their stomachs. Oh, so, you know, it's a great shame that they have to miss a few of these fascinating tales, facts.
Oh, dear, yes, I see. Yes, of course. I must confess some of them are looking a little bit peaky, oh, Mr. Moretti.
Thank you for being so understanding.
Not at all.
Right now, children, I think we're all very, very grateful to Mr. T.R. Davis, the well-known resident guide here at Awern. For many, many years now, isn't it?
Yes, yes.
And, of course, we're also grateful to the owners, and in particular, to Mr. Davies, for allowing us all to meet.
Very kind of you. Thank you. Come along this way, children. That's it. There we are.
Yes, all right. All right, I'll call them now then. Yes. Children, come on. Food is ready. Come on.
Well, look. Isn't it lovely? Yeah. Look at the cakes, Miss Evans.
Yes.
This is meat for you. Aren't you lovely?
You better have a napkin each first.
Here
you
are. Now then, give me a few now.
Come on. Do I take these, will you?
Yes. Now then, come on now, children. You're hungry now, aren't you?
Yes. Thank you.
What do you want? Oh, that'd be lovely. Promise to Mireille.
Give me a one.
Now then, are you all right now, children? What do you want?
What do you want?
A sandwich. What do I... No, you've got enough then. Oh, don't be greedy. No, you've got enough.
Go on.
Now look, you've had enough. Some of you have had enough.
Yes, we get a pack of the crisps for you. Now then, who's going to sit up there?
I'm always glad to see him take a little rest at this stage.
He's enjoying it, isn't he?
Yes.
What could be termed as shibboleth and pro quo. National Library of Wales. Incidentally, children, there are more books per head of population in this town than anywhere else in the world.
Dennis. Dennis Roberts
is
second. Oh,
baby blue.
Get those chicken legs and four tabs of chocolate ice cream.
Foolish boy, we'll have to stop the bus. Maggie, pull up.
You're supposed to be Resap Thomas, not Henry the Eighth. Oh, God Almighty.
Going on, I'm gone, happy, calm, honest, calm. Oh.
beautifully placed, Miss Davis. What is the great significance of this place?
Owain Glyndŵr, sir.
Well, yes, but Owain Glyndŵr roamed all over our country. What special thing did he do here? All right, Gareth, I suppose this one is yours.
In the year 1400, Owain Glyndŵr became the true Prince of Wales. And 3 years later, that is 1403, he called representatives from all parts of Wales to this place, Machynlleth. Not only did they make laws for Wales, but they also made arrangements to establish 2 universities. And of course, made preparations for Owain Glyndŵr's coronation.
Excellent, Gareth. That is it. And children, to understand the meaning of Henry Tudor's journey through Wales, it would help to understand what the Welsh people felt about Owain Glyndŵr. You see, we had become hard-pressed and almost subject people under the Anglo-Normans. And a subject people always wait and pray for a leader who will inspire them to freedom. And Owain Glyndŵr came and he inspired us all right. We sent the English packing. What were the words that Owain Glyndŵr said in Shakespeare's Henry IV? 3 times hath Henry Bolingbroke, who became Henry IV, 3 times hath Henry Bolingbroke made head against my power. Thrice from the banks of the Wye and sandy bottom Severn have I sent him bootless home. Bootless home. But finally, Owain Glyndŵr, with old age creeping on him, could not continue his fight against the might of England. And a dark age came to Wales. To give you an example, the English would not allow Welsh children to be educated. But now, young Henry Tudor was here, and he was planning to carry the fight for freedom into the very heart of England. Of course, in 1975, we don't have the same need. We're all together now and looking towards Europe.
Excuse me, Mr. Meredith.
No, dear.
But you haven't told them about the separation of the 2 armies.
Oh, dear, you're right. I don't know whether I forget because I enjoy this trip more and more each year. Certainly I daydream more. Or is it the irrevocable deterioration of the memory?
Certainly don't look any older, Mr. Meredith.
Bless you. Aye. But there again, you see, a few years ago, I would have spoken the gallant. But in all honesty, Miss Evans, and in no way because you said that to me, I've never seen you look nicer. Well, it's true. Come on, have a cup of tea.
Wife's cold better, Miss Meredith?
Yes, Miss Davis, yes. Thank you very much. Fully recovered.
Right, McHavan. Now, Henry Tudor made a special point of visiting this place, but not to collect more soldiers. Here lived who? Right, Sandra?
David Sawyer.
Right. Now, he composed many poems in praise of Henry Tudor. Who can recite one? Yes, Anne Eckley.
I gave me be name to him, than a name me daddy knew.
Yes. No one reached as high as he. Under heaven, no man will go higher. You see, Wales spoke her propaganda, conveyed her political messages in great poetry. Why, the English regarded Welsh poetry as the most dangerous, disruptive element in the land. And I am proud that the talent for poetry is still with us. As you know, the father of one of our boys is a poet today, a crown bard, and we honor him. And to such a one, Henry Tudor came.
Geraint! Non! Gareth, come on.
Now, what a mess, then. Come on. Nina, what a mess.
Yes, yes, you're right. The puncture was last year, of course. Well, let's start the drama now. All right, Non. Come on, Geraint. In you go. Right, we're about to begin. Gareth, give it all you got now, boy.
Lord Harry, it is an honour to welcome you to our home.
Yes, indeed.
My thanks to you, my loyal friend.
Pray, would you come in and rest a while?
I fear that such pleasures cannot be mine this day. My men and I are tired, and we must make haste, for the night it cometh.
Well, I'm sorry about that.
Your powers have been known to me from childhood, and your fame throughout our beloved land begets me joy. And I have come today in a pilgrimage to ask one thing from you, my friend. How will I fare come battle day? Will I lose or shall I win? 'Tis known the battle will be bloody, but I fear not that. But pray, tell me, sir, who shall stand victor when the day is done?
One moment, Lord.
If I tell him, look, you must.
Prophet, in the name of the House of Tudor, I crave the truth for my future.
Look, if you tell him that he'll win, you'll be rewarded. If he loses, he won't be in any condition to come back here and complain.
Eureka! Wonderful news, good Harry! A great victory! A great victory shall be yours! The red dragon will triumph! Two roses will unite! Good men shall die! Beware the treacherous ones! Two brothers! Their names... the Stanleys! But victory! Harry was, Harry will be, Harry is!
Bravo! 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 But did David Lloyd really know what the outcome of the battle would be?
Now, this is our big stopover, right, Miss Evans? Take it away.
You are now going to see a beautiful sight. A house known as Gregynog, which was built soon after Henry Tudor's time. As you all know, we'll be camping here, spending the night here.
Well, that's very exciting, this now.
So there's no need to rush. We have plenty of time. The fine building is owned today by the University of Wales, which has very kindly given us the facilities at Gregynog free. So let's all behave ourselves.
Thank you.
While King Richard III was on the throne, it was still what we call the medieval period. That is, the Middle Ages. And life throughout Britain was very different then. People ate different food. Why, the rich ate peacocks, boar's heads, swans, venison. But for the poor, life was very hard indeed. Though men, women, and children drank a lot of beer. You see, water in the towns wasn't very good, though I doubt whether the children got drunk. You see, the beer must have been very, very weak. And then people would work from 5 a.m., 5 o'clock in the morning, till 8 o'clock in the evening, eating just two meals a day. That is, if they were lucky. Well, 8 years before Henry Tudor made his memorable journey, a great event took place in Britain. Can anyone tell me what that event was? Yes, Sandra.
Richard Crouchback was made king.
No, no, girl. 8 years ago, and much more important than that. And as I've told you, Richard probably was not a hunchback. No, no, no. The great event that I am speaking of was William Caxton establishing his printing press in Britain. The first, the beginning of books for everybody. Oh, yes, yes, books for everybody. And that, Dennis Roberts, includes the Hotspur comic, or whatever is the equivalent today. And then, over in Italy, at that time, they were already well and truly out of the Middle Ages. Oh, those Italians were blooming with what is called the Renaissance. The revival of art and sophistication. You know, polished thinking. And who, at that time, over in Italy, was the same age as King Richard III? A great, great Italian. Michelangelo. A great artist. Oh, yes, those Italians were way ahead of us at that sort of thing. Well, I think that we have had a very good day. We've had an adventurous journey, a good campfire supper, and a magic lantern show. So let's round off the day by singing our national anthem. Oh, and remember, England is just over there. So make sure that they hear you. Right, on your feet. One, two, three.
My inner
And now we are approaching Cefn Dugorch. This was the place, just east of Welshpool, where Henry Tudor had arranged to meet Rhys ap Thomas and his fighting Welshmen. He must have hoped and prayed that they would be there. Was Rhys ap Thomas of Dinevor there? Gareth.
Yes, sir. With 2,000 fighting Welshmen, picked soldiers.
Yes, he was there. And William ap Griffith arrived with men from Gwynedd and Richard ap Howell arrived from Powys. Groups of Welshmen marched in from all corners of Wales. It was like a descent on Twickenham rugby football ground. Though, on this occasion when the two sides met, there would be a lot more blood flying. This is the fine medieval town of Shrewsbury. Now, careful with your heads now. Look, taking those photos, Miss Evans, look, those photos. Oh, dear. Henry Tudor was pushing into England. The magistrate of this place wouldn't at first open the city gates. The first signs of opposition. Ever eastward into England, Henry Tudor and his Welshmen pushed. Here at Newport, 500 Shropshire gentlemen joined, the first English soldiers. How many men did Henry Tudor have now? Yes, Meyer Jones.
He had about 5,000 men.
Correct. Now, did Henry Tudor know yet how many soldiers King Richard had? Howell?
He was hearing rumours, sir.
What were those rumours? Bethan?
King Richard had twice as many.
Yes, about double. Certainly 9,000 men. Well, Henry Tudor must have been worried. What were Richard's feelings? Do we know? Patrick?
He must have felt very confident, Smredin.
Well, perhaps. Now, listen carefully. We know that Henry Tudor was heavily outnumbered, 2-1. But there were two large forces of men in the vicinity, and no one could be sure which side they would join. These two forces were led by Sir William Stanley from North Wales, and the other was led by his brother Lord Stanley from the northeast of England. Their total strength amounted to some 6,000 soldiers. Oh, they could swing the battle. Yeah! Was in a cruel situation if he wanted to fight for Henry Tudor, because King Richard was holding his son and heir as a hostage. What is a hostage? Huh? Gwenda?
A prisoner, sir.
Yes, a prisoner who could be killed if anything went wrong. Like fate itself, Henry Tudor marched eastward to his nemesis. What is nemesis? Huh? Fate! Now, on to Bosworth!
Now, let the battle commence.
No serious injuries now. Well, there we are. That is the story, you see. You see, Henry Tudor here was now Henry the Seventh, and his line of Welsh people included his son, Henry the Eighth, and his granddaughter, Queen Elizabeth the First. Oh, yes, we've given quite a bit of liveliness, you see, to Britain. Oh, what a lovely day. Lovely, lovely day.
Meredith?
Yes, ma'am?
Did Richard III kill Lord Stanley's son?
No. No, he did not. Good girl. Good girl.
Well, Mr. Meredith, we won, didn't we?
Well, yes, we won. But somehow, it didn't make much difference to life back home in Wales. Henry Tudor was very, very nice to his Welsh people, but I think it would be fair to say that the heir, as it were, to Owen Glyndŵr's spirit sacrificed the aspirations, you know, the hopes of his Welsh people. Of course, we were very, very happy to have won here at Bosworth, but somehow in winning, it took the sting out of our tail. Except for Gareth and his friends, eh? Thank you.